Good evening and welcome to our prayer this evening for our faithful departed. And we begin as always with the Angelus. The angel of the Lord declared unto Mary, and she conceived of the Holy Spirit. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Behold the handmaid of the Lord, be it done unto me according to thy word. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt amongst us. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Pray for us, O Holy Mother of God, that we may be made worthy of the promises of Christ. Let us pray. Pour forth, we beseech thee, O Lord, thy grace into our hearts, that we, to whom the incarnation of Christ thy Son was made known by the message of an angel, may, by his passion and cross, be brought to the glory of his resurrection, through the same Christ our Lord. Amen. This evening's reflection comes from the Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God still and trust in me. There are many rooms in my Father's house. If there were not, I should have told you. I am going now to prepare a place for you, and after I have gone and prepared you a place, I shall return to take you with me, so that where I am, you may be too. You know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said, "Lord, we do not know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me." It's been the object of endless and sometimes pointless speculation in the minds of some people about the afterlife. What's it like? What's heaven like? What's life after death? And many alarming images have been produced from the imaginations of many people over the centuries in literature and films to give their idea of what lies beyond the grave. We really shouldn't waste our energies on those unhelpful images. Instead, we should turn to this passage from John's Gospel. It's always a risk to use human imagery in any way to describe something that is beyond our experience and beyond our imagination. We will never accurately conceive an image of heaven in our minds. But we are human, and we need things to help us, within our own experience to grasp the truths behind these mysteries of faith. And in this gospel particularly, Jesus uses an image that is most certainly not frightening. On the contrary, it couldn't be more reassuring. That famous gospel passage about the many rooms in his Father's house. It's reassuring because it says there are many rooms to begin with. There's the familiarity of having your own place to be admitted to the Father's house. Home for all of us conjures up different things. For most of us, I hope, those are images that are of comfort and are supportive to us. Not to do with the bricks and mortar, but to do with the relationships and the nurturing and the comfort that we have felt there. A place where we can be ourselves, where we don't get away with airs and graces, where we don't need to because we are known and loved for who we are. So it's really significant that Jesus uses that image to evoke those ideas in people's minds, to prevent them being fearful about what lies beyond for those who have died, but rather to be comforted by that image that they have gone home, gone home to their father's house, to a place that Jesus has prepared for them. But in case we would think of this as some physical place, the question that is asked of the disciples is if it was somewhere they could have a map or have directions to, how can we know the way? Jesus tells them that he is the way, the truth, and the life. That for those who have lived in that relationship, not always perfect in our parts, we know well that our sinfulness at times will damage our relationship with Jesus. But through the sacrament of baptism, strengthened by confirmation and enriched when we receive the Eucharist, that bond, that link between ourselves and Jesus can never be completely broken. And even if we do on occasion become lazy or stretch the relationship a little bit, we know that it is recoverable through the sacrament of reconciliation. It's not some secret knowledge of a direction to take that may be difficult, that may involve all these decisions. It's rather this relationship with a person. And therefore, when we pray for our brothers and sisters who have died, we are praying for that relationship that they had with Jesus Christ, more or less explicit, perhaps expressed in a life of piety and devotion, perhaps expressed in other ways that were less visible to those around, but were visible to the Lord, since this relationship is deep in our heart. Who knows what relationships existed between our loved ones and Jesus, our Saviour, even if they weren't expressed in visible ways. We pray that the bonds that are there and that desire that God has for the salvation of all and for this friendship with his creation will have sustained our brothers and sisters who have died and bring them to that ultimate place that God wants them to be, that we pray for them to be, and that they, in the deepest desires of their heart, always wanted to be with God forever in heaven. Out of the depths I have cried to thee, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let thine ears be attentive to the voice of my supplication. If thou, O Lord, would mark iniquities, Lord, who would survive? For with thee there is mercy, and by reason of thy law I have waited on thee, O Lord. My soul hath relied in his word, my soul hath hoped in the Lord. From the morning watch even until night, let Israel hope in the Lord. For with the Lord there is mercy, and with him plentiful redemption, and he will redeem Israel from all his iniquities. Eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon them. May they rest in peace. Amen. May their souls and the souls of all the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace. Amen. And now for a few moments of personal quiet prayer, let's bring to the Lord all the intentions of our hearts for our dearly beloved faithful departed.
Splash!
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Let us pray. What no eye has seen, no ear heard, nor human heart conceived, God has prepared for those who love him. God of all consolation, in your unending love and mercy, you turn the darkness of death into the dawn of new life. Show compassion to your people in their sorrow. Be our refuge and our strength to lift us from the darkness of grief to the peace and light of your presence. Your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by dying for us, conquered death, and by rising again, restored life. May we then go forward eagerly to meet him, and after our life on earth, be reunited with our brothers and sisters, where every tear will be wiped away. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. May the Lord grant us a quiet night and a perfect end.